Blackstone presents Misogynoir Transformed, Black Women's Digital Resistance by Moya Bailey. This book is read by Moya Bailey. For Mama and Daddy. We cannot sit on our behinds waiting for someone else to do it for us. We must save ourselves. Marianne Weathers, An Argument for Black Women's Liberation as a Revolutionary Force, 1969. Preface. Although I did not know it at the time, I started writing this book as an undergraduate at Spelman College. I was on the road to becoming a medical doctor when two things happened that made me shift course. I fell in love with women's studies, and I got international attention as one of the leaders of a small pushback on campus against the rapper Nelly. Both events profoundly shaped my thinking about the way Black women are treated in society and moved me to coin the term misogynoir, which in turn led to this book. As a first-year student from tiny Fayetteville, Arkansas, I was appalled when Dr. Beverly Guy-Sheftall told the Spelman College entering class of 2005 about Sarah Bartman's experiences as a human exhibit in Europe during the early 19th century. Bartman, a young Khoisan woman from what we now recognize as South Africa, was displayed throughout Europe to paying white audiences as an example of the animalistic and inferior nature of the African woman. Implicit in Bartman's display was a comparison between her body and that of the white women who viewed her. European scientists equated Bartman's anatomical differences with sexual deviance, drawing conclusions about her sexuality and subsequently the sexuality of Black women from her form. Her butt and genitalia were used to justify racist and sexualized violence, as well as the continued enslavement of Africans in the New World. Dr. Guy-Sheftall explained that the exploitative way Bartman's body was treated in life and in death was made possible under the guise of objective science, though what Bartman actually endured was objectification through scientific racism and sexism. In my first week at Spelman, before I had even attended a class, Dr. Guy-Sheftall had challenged my thinking by describing the differential treatment Black women experienced on a global stage. After that moment, I knew I wanted to take every class I could with her. I was awakened to the profundity of the unique nexus of experience that is Black and woman on this planet and throughout colonial history. Along with enrolling in Dr. Guy-Sheftall's classes, I took classes with fellow feminist professor Dr. M. Bahati Kaumba, Dr. K., who gave me the final nudge into the open arms of the comparative women's studies major at Spelman. As I was matriculating, I also got involved in the feminist political organizations on campus, all of which were supported by the Women's Research and Resource Center, the home of the Comparative Women's Studies Department. It was Dr. K. who asked, "You're taking all the classes. Why not be a major?" When she put it that way, there was no room for rebuttal. But in truth, I was a willing convert, despite still having every intention of attending medical school, but that was not to be. As a 19-year-old junior and then president of the Feminist Majority Leadership Alliance, FMLA, I showed the group Nelly's music video for the song Tip Drill, which had started airing on the late-night television show Uncut on BET, Black Entertainment Television. The video featured most memorably a scene where Nelly slides a credit card down the crack of a Black woman's butt. Our group decided to name him our Misogynist of the Month, not knowing that the Spelman Student Government Association had agreed to partner with Nelly and his foundation, Jesus for Jackie, to hold a bone marrow registration drive on our campus in an effort to save the life of his sister, who had leukemia. FMLA raised questions about the misogynoir in his video and lyrics, And when we heard that Nelly was invited to campus, it seemed only fair that we ask him about the way he represented Black women, since he was asking us for help. Nelly declined our offer to talk about his music. Instead, he went to the press, twisting the story such that it seemed that Spellman canceled the bone marrow registration drive because of the video, an assertion that many still believe today, though we orchestrated our own drive. The story garnered national and eventually international headlines, both praising and condemning Spellman students for daring to talk back to the music. It was a hard lesson in the hypervisibility and invisibility of being a Black woman. Nelly felt entitled to our assistance with saving his sister's life, but did not feel that he had to address us, the Black women who dealt with the fallout of his video and lyrics in our day-to-day lives. As young Black women, we felt the impact of the video and lyrics in the form of street harassment in the United States and abroad. We dealt with assumptions about our sexual availability to men in the form of unsolicited commentary on our bodies, on our clothing, and on our time. He used his celebrity, built on the bodies of Black women, to urge people to support an underappreciated cause, the health of Black women. Black women are far less likely to find a matching bone marrow donor than their white woman counterparts, in part because of Black people's deep distrust of the systemic racism in medicine, which makes them less likely to volunteer to donate. What was not quite clear to me in 2004 was the irony of using a fame garnered through limiting representations of Black women while refusing to address that decision and also wanting support from those very same Black women. I wasn't quite able to connect the dots between popular media representations of Black women and my and other Black women's experiences with discriminatory housing practices, intimate partner violence, street harassment, employment discrimination, and ill treatment from healthcare providers. But my interest in the role media plays in shaping the perceptions of Black women became all-consuming, such that the goal of becoming a medical doctor morphed into getting a doctorate to investigate the role that media representations play in the treatment of Black women patients by white doctors. I learned about the ways historical popular culture seeped into the consciousness of supposedly objective future physicians, which prompted me to consider how popular cultural representations influence Black women's treatment in society.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.